Control
Okay.
Welcome, everybody. We'll start in about 2 minutes. If you'd like to type in the chat box for everyone to see, we or just for me, be nice to know where you are located. It's always helpful, especially with designing, because different designs are going to be affected by the climate. Oh, Orlando, Florida. I hope you didn't get hit too bad. Winnipeg, Manitoba. I was born in Churchill, Manitoba. Anybody else want to share where you are located? We still have 1 more minute before we get started. Start at the top of the hour, which for us here in Florida and Kentucky is 3 o'clock. Minnesota. I used to live in Minnesota. I'm not sure where
All my
Crossland
family lives in Minnesota,
is. Good.
in Laverne, way on the South Dakota border.
Ah. Okay, I have 3 o'clock, so we are going to get started. You can continue to type in the chat box where you're located if you'd like. Gives us a little bit of help. My name is Dr. Jackie Jacob. I'm at the University of Kentucky, a state poultry specialist. I work with small and backyard flocks around the country. As part of my job, I run the webinars for the community of practice on e-extension, which is the electronic version of the Cooperative Extension Service, which is a program here in United States. And so every month we have different webinars. They're all recorded. You can go to our YouTube channel anytime and check out some of the old ones. You can also go to our main website and link on webinars and past webinars to find out what we've done before, and you can find the upcoming webinars as well. So for today's webinar, it's going to be on designing a poultry house, right? So I can't remember the title. And we have Alicia from Florida, who survived the storm, to give us the presentation. While she is presenting, you can start sharing anytime. While she is presenting, I will be on mute with my camera off. I will be monitoring the Q&A box as well as the chat box. If you have a question, type it in at any time. If it is a clarification of something that she's talking about at that time, my camera will come back on and I'll unmute and ask the clarification question. Otherwise, we'll hold the questions to the end. If you're like me, if I don't, do it right away, I'll forget what the question was. So if you think of something, feel free to type it in. As I said, I'll be monitoring it, and if it's essential to what she's talking about, I will pop up. Otherwise, I'll be quiet. So it's all yours now, Alicia.
Thank you. So like Jackie said, my name is Alicia Halberter. I am an agriculture and natural resources extension agent with the University of Florida. I'm located in Baker County, so that's just west of Jacksonville, in the eastern northeastern corner of Florida. So we did get some impacts from the storm. Most of us were without power till Sunday or so. Luckily, majority of our impacts are minimal, bar a few, major trees on houses and things. Of course, in our thoughts are all those that were severely impacted by the storm in Florida and all the way up the East Coast. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about some considerations that you should make in your coop plans. So, whether you already have a chicken coop or whether you're looking at building one, these are things that you could add, subtract, or think about in your future coops. I will go ahead and apologize that our internet and cell phone service is not that great in Baker County right now because of the storm. So I'm sorry if we have a little delay or anything. Just let me know if I start to phase out, and I'll turn my camera off. Sometimes that can help. So the first thing I want to talk about, my slides are already going, is again just an overview of the considerations that you should make. So we'll talk about keeping chickens in and predators out of our coop, room to move within those coops, the general chicken activities that you should consider, your biosecurity plan, of course, that's always going to be a top priority for us, cleaning and replacing some of the items in your coop, the sturdiness and hardiness of the items that you're utilizing, and then how you can adapt and grow in your future chicken keeping plans. So, of course, most of our coops are designed to keep our chickens in. Even if you plan to free range chickens, typically you're going to have some space where they could be locked up at night, contained during bad weather, all of these different considerations that you may need to keep them cooped up. Even if you're usually planning to free range your chickens, I always recommend that you build some type of outdoor run onto your coop. So if you do have really bad periods of weather, your chickens can still get in and out, and they don't have to be locked into a small space like just the inside of your coop. That can be really important. So none of the materials that you use in your coop design should pose any risk for your birds to get their heads stuck or their feet stuck. So we don't want to use chicken wire on the sides. So that's like that kind of hexagonal, really weak material that a lot of people just commonly call chicken wire. If that's on the sides, they can stick their head through, they could potentially get stuck, or predators can reach in through those large holes and grab your chickens, and that can be a big problem. We see a lot of people complaining coming out to their coop and they have headless chickens because a raccoon easily grabbed their chicken through that chicken wire. And then, of course, we don't want something with such large holes on the bottom of our coop where our chickens are expected to walk across because they can't really balance on such a large hole and they will fall through, getting their legs stuck and cause injuries. None of that material should bow, flex, or be easily moved where your chickens can get stuck. So sometimes I see people using like a bird netting on as the sidewalls of their coops, and they might staple it to the post that they're using to hold it up, but if that material can move, if it come rips out of those staples or anything, you might get chickens stuck in between those, or getting tangled up in that netting. So consider that kind of factors as well and what materials you decide to use. And then your chickens should feel calm and comfortable in that chicken coop. That's the main design of that facility there, but the aesthetics are really just for you. They don't care how pretty it is. So think about that in your design. You can make it as fancy as you'd like or as, plain Jane as you'd like. As far as keeping our predators out, I always am going to recommend hardware cloth as any kind of open air sidewall. So you can see in that top picture there where those chickens are bound in with hardware cloth. So that's actually a welded wire. And it's very sturdy, very hard to get through. It doesn't rust very readily. And then when we're talking about our digging predators, especially foxes, sometimes possums, and maybe weasels, stoats, things like that, that you're going to find in the northern regions, we like to bury that hardware cloth in an L shape, so facing out towards your coop, not in towards your coop. And that really deters our digging predators. They're going to dig on the edge of that coop. They're going to hit that L shape that's extending out at least a foot beyond your coop wall, and they're not going to go any further. Usually, they're not going to try hard enough to figure out how far back they have to dig and how far down or under that wire they have to dig in order to get in there into your chickens. They were looking for a quick, easy meal, and you deterred that. So that can help a lot with our digging predators. Using a smaller or sturdy wire like hardware cloth also helps prevent raccoons, possums, some of our snakes, all kinds of things that we might deal with, especially in the south, from either getting into the coop, reaching into the coop, or actually physically breaking that wire. I see that sometimes with chicken wire, especially if it's got some rusty spots, which in the southeast, we deal a lot with rust because of those hot, humid conditions. They're easily able to just, you know, kind of manhandle that wire and break it and get in and access to your birds. And then always going to recommend putting a roof over those areas. So whether that is a completely covered roof, like tin or wood, anything like that, or even just hardware cloth or potentially bird netting on the top, that's going to help prevent our flying predators like hawks, eagles in some areas, and owls at night from getting our access to our birds. And if we use those more sturdy materials like hardware cloth, wood, or tin, that's also going to prevent our climbing predators, possums, raccoons, weasels, all of those from getting into the coop from up above. So that's keeping predators out is probably going to be one of the main decisions or factors you're thinking about when you're talking about design and also material use of your coop. So we want our birds to have some room to move. And so we do have some minimum spacing requirements per bird. So typically inside of the coop, so this is going to be the area that's going to generally house your roosts where your chickens are going to stay at night and your nest boxes, maybe potentially have your feeders and waters. It's typically the enclosed space of your overall chicken housing situation. We typically want between 2 and 3 square feet per bird inside of that coop. So that allows them space to move away from each other, especially in the heat, to where they're not all piled up on each other and just accumulating that heat. And, you know, allows you in the winter space to deep bed them so they can stay warm, all kinds of considerations there into what that space is. Now, that is the space recommendation for chickens. If you are going to have bantam chickens, if you're going to have, that obviously would be, you know, require less space. If you're going to have turkeys or waterfowl or anything of that, there are some larger space requirements for those birds you would have to consider. And you can, you know, easily find that on our extension resources, or if you have questions about that, we can discuss that at the end. And then on the outside, so typically this would be considered or called the run of your chicken coop. We typically recommend about 10 square foot per bird of outdoor space for them. So this again could be covered with tin, but is normally going to be have open side walls covered with some kind of wire for, you know, fresh air and all of that. So that's going to give your birds plenty of room to move around, plenty of room to add to your flock if you build it pretty large. And, you know, just give them the considerations to maintain the social aspects in your flock. If you have some really mean hens or a mean rooster, and it gives them that room to get away from each other if need be. All right. And so also we want to consider our chicken activities. And so this are three main behaviors that our chickens have that we want to consider when we're talking about building their housing. Roosting is going to be one of the most important things. So roosting is basically how our chickens sleep. They roost up in trees naturally as birds or any high space. We're obviously providing them some kind of bar or, you know, flat surface in order to roost on. So you want to consider about 6 inches of roosting space per bird. These roosts should be at least a foot above or a foot apart from each other if you have multiple levels of roost, and typically are about 18 to 24 inches above the floor. For chickens, we don't want to get much higher than 4 feet above the floor because if they're jumping down from that, you can cause some leg injuries or some feet issues over time, joint issues if they're doing that, you know, for extended period of their life. And so we want that to be kind of on the lower end, or have a lot of steppage where they can easily get down to the lower levels and don't have to jump from a high point all the way to the ground. For our nest boxes, we need to consider that you need to have each nest box to be about 1 square foot. So that's 12 inches by 12 inches. They don't really have to be much bigger than that unless you're going to choose some of our really big dual purpose breeds Or, you know, just some of those bigger breeds, you can give them a little more space, but you don't want your nest boxes to be too big because then your chickens can move those eggs around a lot and they're more prone to breaking. When we're talking about number of nest boxes, you should provide two nest boxes for the first four laying hens that you have, and then one nest box for every additional four hens after that. So if you have 12 hens, you should have two nest boxes for the first four, one for the second four, and one for the second four. So you'd have four total nest boxes for those 12 hens. If they're anything like my chickens, they'll probably all use one, maybe two nest boxes, but we want to have that opportunity available for them to utilize those other nest boxes if they can. And then chickens do bathe. They don't typically bathe in water, but they actually bathe in dust or dirt. And so we want to give them an opportunity to satisfy that natural behavior. You can either use, you know, an old wash tub or a garden pot, all kinds of things I've seen used for a dust bath. There are some recipes per se out there for your dust bath materials that you can use. Just be extra cautious of what you're finding online. You don't typically want to use diatomaceous earth when we're talking about chickens. You know, if you're using wood ash or anything of that sort that I've seen recommended, you know, just be really cautious of what species were burned in that, making sure there was no toxic species that could be remaining, or toxic chemicals, anything of that sort that was might be present in that ash. Typically, you know, just natural dirt is going to be the best for them. You know, don't use potting soil or anything that could have fertilizer, vermiculite, anything like that inside of it. You can also just allow them to dust bathe naturally in your run as long as you're not filling that 100% with sand or shavings, anything of that sort. They need to have access to the natural ground in order to dust bathe, or you're providing, again, some type of container with the natural dirt inside of there. And then that, you know, dust bath could be located anywhere in the coop if you decided to put that in some type of container. So biosecurity, you can never have an extension program about livestock without talking about biosecurity, especially with poultry or any kind of bird species. We have to be really cautious about, you know, the diseases that we can transmit to them and they can transmit to us. So I typically always recommend for people to mount hand sanitizer directly to their chicken coop. So there are, you know, hand soap dispensers that can be mounted, you know, little wire cages that you can easily slip the stuff in and out of to replace. But that is just so it's always there. You never have to think about it. You don't have to go, you know, in and out of your house to wash your hands. It's great if you have a hand washing station there. You know, just a hose that you're rinsing off your hands in is not really ideal. You would want some type of soap, and something there. But clean water access, soap, and/or you know, hand sanitizer there is going to be best. And use that before entering your coop and after exiting your coop. And that way you're protecting yourself and protecting your birds. And then, you know, primarily, especially up kind of, I would say, in the Midwestern areas or areas where commercial poultry is really prevalent, is we don't want to allow wildlife or especially wild birds to have access to our coop. So we don't want them to be able to fly into the coop, roost with our birds, nest in there, or access our birds' feed, because that is how a lot of diseases are communicated from bird to bird. And where we have large areas of commercial poultry, we could, you know, really spread some disastrous diseases there. So those areas need to be extra cognizant of how they play into the role of the spread of avian diseases. So making sure, you know, those little songbirds, all of those things that can easily get into to small spaces, don't have any access into our chicken coop is going to be really key. But, you know, other diseases can be transmitted to our birds from other wildlife potentially. And so we want to make sure, again, just any wildlife don't have access to our feed or our coop. And sometimes even the surrounding area, like in the southeast, we have a lot of vector-borne diseases that can affect our chickens. And so those are diseases that are spread mainly by mosquitoes. And so we need to, you know, consider some mosquito control in our design area as well. So this is kind of think about yourself and make it easy on yourself when you're talking about coop plans and designs. Chickens can be really smelly, especially if there is a lot of moisture. So their manure is very high in ammonia. And if you've ever opened a bottle of cleaning ammonia or use cleaning products that are high in ammonia, you know it can be, you know, really jarring to the system. And chickens have really sensitive respiratory systems. So we need to be considerate of them and be considerate to ourselves by adding a lot of ventilation in our coops. This is the key thing I see that is lacking in prefabricated coops. I always recommend that if people are purchasing prefabricated coops, that they go and add additional ventilation into their coops, because it's normally not sufficient in those types of pre-purchased coops. So you'll see in this photo here an example. There are little holes all along the top of that coop that's allowing the transfer of that nasty air that's in that coop to escape and fresh air to come in. Of course, we're making sure that all of those holes are covered with hardware cloth or some kind of welded wire, chicken, wire, if we're trying to be financially feasible, something that's going to help prevent our predators from getting in there. And, smaller songbirds or anything that could potentially access those holes. So ventilation, always key. Add as much ventilation as you possibly can in a coop. You really can't go wrong with adding too much ventilation, as long as those ventilation points can either be closed or, adapted for winter weather, because too much ventilation in winter can cause some issues as well. But yes, so ventilation is going to help control that smell and moisture as well, and is really going to be the key to having an enjoyable coop for you and your chickens. Always, always, always consider the access to your coop. I am a big proponent of human-sized doors in coops, and this is coming from, someone who has owned chickens for a long time, and I visit a lot of people with chickens on site visits and all sort of things. And you will not want to clean, you will not want to, go in there and properly care for your chickens if the access to your coop is annoying in any way, shape, or form. If you, have to bend down and stick your hand in there and try and get into something, if your equipment like shovels, anything like that, or a nuisance to get in there, it's just going to really irritate you, and you're probably not going to do it, which is going to be a detriment to you and your chickens. So always, plan if you can have in your design some type of human-sized, run, at least where you can walk into the run comfortably, and then maybe, some other access points into the enclosed coop if you don't want to build that large enough where you can get inside of it. You'll see in the example here that I have where their run is completely accessible to people. It has a human-sized door in there, and it is overhead height. And then they have a prefabricated coop inside of that run. They're able to, clean out and manage as best as they can. And so that at least allows them to have access in there to the chickens without having to like crouch down or anything. And then of course the ease of caring for your chickens, cleaning out your chickens, that's going to be really important as well. So you'll see like in this little coop example that I have there over that title, it's got a little door. If you have that coop itself is probably only about, waist, maybe shoulder high on me, and the run is barely waist high. And so when you're getting in there and trying to feed these chickens, you're like literally crawling on the ground, trying to lift these feeders up on hangers. And again, it just gets really aggravating. So if it's going to be annoying to get materials in and out, so bedding, nesting materials, eggs in and out, placing the feed or the water, spot cleaning, or even completely renovating. So at some point, you're likely going to have to take out all of the bedding and replace it with clean, fresh bedding. And consider those factors. And then either in location or the design of your coop, can you get a wheelbarrow nearby? Because sometimes you may need to, scoop out a large amount of shavings or whatever bedding material you eventually decide on into a wheelbarrow and then transport to some kind of compost bin or offsite location. So, making sure you have access to a wheelbarrow, if you're lucky enough to have a tractor, loader, wagon attached to your lawnmower, something of that sort. Think about those considerations in your design and in your coop location. And then, of course, the materials that you use to build the coop, add on to a prefabricated coop, anything of that sort. We want to make sure they are durable and easy to clean. So, vinyl is always going to be a great recommendation for chickens. I've seen people purchase the really cheap, I mean, I think Dollar Tree even sells like the sticky vinyl tiles that you can put down on the flooring. This example that I grabbed from Facebook, they used like polyvinyl plastic sheeting. I believe theirs came in 4-foot by 8-foot sheets, and they just ran it down and, glue or staple it to the ground and easily are able to clean up after their chickens for that. Make sure if you plan to wash out your coop at any point that there are access points or drains for the water to get out, or an ability to squeegee that or something. But any type of vinyl flooring or, vinyl plastic sheeting is going to make cleanup really easy. Just be cautious if you're using rakes, shovels, anything like that. That could potentially tear a thinner vinyl plastic if you choose to go that route. So we want to make sure that our coops are sturdy and hardy. So, of course, materials that we choose are probably going to be the biggest factor here on how our coops withstand, weather, birds, predators, all kinds of things. So they should be the best available to, and that's financially feasible for you. Of course, I'm not going to tell everyone that you need to go out and, buy steel beams and weld all your coop together and make sure it is just, atomic bomb proof. We understand that there are a wide range of chicken keepers out there and they all have different goals and abilities. And so whatever is feasible for you, just make sure that it is the best to your ability. And just remember that, cheaper materials at that time often require frequent repair or frequent replacing, which ends up being more expensive than if to just fork out for those better materials in the beginning. And then again, I kind of already mentioned this, but, chicken wire readily rusts, especially in the Southeast where it's hot and humid. Thin wood rots really quickly, and so it often has to be replaced. Some materials can be easily broken by predators. This could be like the latches you choose to put on the doors, any type of material that you're choosing to use, and that anything that you do design and or build should always be able to withstand that your particular climate's most severe weather or overall threats. So are bears really prevalent in your area? Your coop needs to somewhat be able to withstand or mitigate the factors of, a threat from a bear. In Florida, I'm going to be worried about wind and hurricanes, flooding, issues like that with moisture or weather of large rain events. You might be concerned about snow. I see a lot of you are from, the Northeast, Canada, Minnesota, Maine. Snow is going to be a problem for you. So making sure we have really good pitched roofs so we're not out there worrying about shoveling snow off of our chicken coop roofs. Is it able to be adapted to maintain temperatures so your chickens aren't freezing? Frostbite isn't an issue. They have some sort of run access that isn't covered in snow on the ground. All of those considerations. I can tell you as a Florida native, I'm not going to be able to talk too much about, your adaptions for snow, but it's, kind of a lot of the same factors you're talking about with your house. So extreme weather, we want to make sure our coops are going to be able to withstand that. And then there is no math like chicken math. So we want to make sure that we are ready to adapt and grow our coops for whatever needs may arise. So if you want to add more chickens, if you want to get waterfowl like ducks or geese, potentially turkeys, is your coop able to be able to accommodate those various needs for those different species of birds? You know, can you separate off a section that they might not have access to your chickens? Is it large enough for them? Can you add additional feeders for a larger flock size? All of these considerations, you know, the bigger that you go, the better it's going to be for those changes you might encounter. Weather, of course, can your coop be adapted to the changing weather conditions to protect your birds from flooding, freezing, or even heat? In Florida, we face a lot of issues with heat. Can fans be added, misters, all kinds of things? And maybe power access nearby is vital. So you may need to add, you know, some kind of heat source if you're going to have chicks out there, if you're going to have, you know, freezing conditions at night. Or, you know, maybe you just want a light in there to extend your day length because you were really looking for heavy egg production. There's all kinds of factors there as far as power and weather. And then separation is a big thing as well. Sometimes we do encounter the need to separate birds. So if it's one individual bird that may be injured, it may be the bottom of the pecking order and, you know, its comb is just really getting beat up and we need to separate it so it has time to heal. And it got some other type of injury. We're getting new birds and we want to quarantine some birds. Or, you know, we're got sucked into the tractor supply, you know, cute chicks. When I walked in there to get chicken feed and brought a few home, maybe I need a separation for a chick grow out or a brooder box in there. Maybe I'm getting into meat chickens and I want a separation of meat chickens versus layers. So, you know, always consider, is there a way or some type of access in your coop or a separate coop type that you can build that allows for some type of separation if needed for your birds there. So general suggestions, high quality materials are always going to be great. I'm always going to recommend hardware cloth. If you can use tin for roofing, pressure treated wood for any type of ground contact is going to be necessary. And really any other high quality materials that you can consider is going to be really helpful for the longevity and the durability of your coop. Make it as big as you can afford and, you know, as your regulations in your city or town or county might allow you to. Poultry very hardly complain about too much space, and this allows for a lot of future adaption or change for you. And then always remember that aesthetics is really just for you. Make it as pleasing to the eye as you want it to be. So some people are, you know, really on the scale of they want their chicken coop to completely match the, you know, overall look of their home. They want to go in and wallpaper the inside of the walls. They want to paint it, you know, and then some people just kind of want to slap four pieces of wood together and make a coop and, you know, let their chickens in and out. And all is perfectly fine as long as our chickens are happy and healthy. Always going to recommend that function is your high priority over looks. So we want to make sure that it's easy to clean, easy for our chickens to access, get in safely to their run, all kinds of things we can consider there as far as chicken health and happiness, and making sure that that is our first priority over how it looks overall. And so I just want to kind of go through a couple examples and ideas for you and talk about some highlights or maybe some considerations that I didn't quite like on each of these photos. And I just have two slides here. There are hundreds of thousands of photos of chicken coops that have been done out there. There are tons of Facebook groups specifically dedicated to chicken coops, helping you design, build, you know, or factor in some considerations there to get ideas from. So I encourage you to really go out and look and see how you can change your current chicken coop or build one that's going to, you know, be your perfect consideration for your chickens. So in this first picture here on the left with the blue coop and the little yellow chicken windows, you can see that there is a lot of ventilation access there. All of those little yellow doors open. And they are closable and lockable. They all have a sliding latch there. So that's going to be really great for predator proofing, great for, you know, summer heat to let that hot air escape because that ventilation is in that upper kind of point there of the coop. and lockable, of course, so you can lock your chickens up in there at night and no threat to predators. And then a lot of these examples I'm going to show you today have this nest box that is accessible from the outside of the coop. And so that's always great, especially if you're a lazy chicken keeper like me and you just want to be able to walk up, lift that little latch up, pick up your eggs, and go on about your day. And it doesn't have to be like a whole thing of getting into your coop, climbing in, finding the eggs, etc. And so some type of outdoor access there to the egg box is always helpful. In that second photo there, you can see, again, a really great, you know, ventilation there, an outside accessible egg box. And then I kind of want to highlight here where they have that underrun area. So they raised up the actual enclosed coop portion. You'll see this on a lot of our smaller prefabricated coops. And this is really just the maximization of space. So you're allowing your chickens more run space. If that coop were to be on the ground, obviously your birds would have very minimal run space in that coop. So maximization of space is really helpful if you have county or city regulations that require you to have a smaller coop. And you can get, you know, a few more birds in there with that kind of mindset. Any type of, you know, refrigeration or, you know, utilizing other materials is great. You'll see that middle picture there of our kind of festive Halloween bright color chicken coop. That is actually a child's playhouse that somebody renovated into a chicken coop. So anytime you can reuse materials and make it work for you is going to be great. Highly recommend that, of course, making sure that, you know, it is sturdy, it's not containing, you know, any toxic materials or anything there for our chickens or is going to be detrimental to them. But, you know, reduce, reuse, recycle is going to be great for your budget and still be suitable for all of your chicken needs. That fourth photo there, I just kind of wanted to highlight that rarely are those prefabricated chicken coops that you find in feed stores, Tractor Supply. You know, I hate to be a Debbie Downer on them, but they are usually not made with very high quality materials. They're usually rather expensive, but very cheaply made, and very small. Some of them, you know, if you look in that fourth photo, I bet that small chicken coop that's inside of there probably says it could hold 6 to 10 chickens. And obviously our recommended spacing requirements are not going to be met there. With 6 to 10 chickens, even 4 to 6 chickens, that is entirely too small. So typically I, you know, if people are looking at purchasing those in the meantime, consider building a larger run outside of that. And so you'll see there, they built a large run over top of a prefabricated coop. So maybe you are not the building type. You don't really have a lot of tools and materials or anything. You could build that outer run there with very minimal resources. Pretty much all of those posts would not need to be cut. They wouldn't need to be sized. Or if they did, you could easily do that at a local hardware store that offers that. Friend that has a saw, you know, borrow one, rent one, anything of that sort. But you wouldn't have to have the building expertise to be able to build that enclosed coop, which is, you know, usually requires more education and materials. So again, kind of just adapting to the conditions there would be helpful. And then on this last one, I just wanted to show you that another resource is a lot of people will buy sheds and use that as their enclosed coop, and it's kind of a larger area. You can tell I really like this one because it's got human access doors into the larger enclosed area of the coop, and then has that long extended run on the outside of it. In an ideal world, to me, that long extended run would probably be more head height. I'm really short, so I could probably fit in there relatively comfortably, but most people could not. So take that into consideration when you're thinking about design plans, that you may already have a shed that you're not really utilizing and could easily be converted into a chicken coop. Yes, Jackie makes a good point there. No lead paint. Anytime you're painting or reusing products, make sure we're not using any lead paint. And so this first example here on the left on this slide just shows you, again, you can make it really pretty. You can make it as design and aesthetically pleasing as you would like. That's really up to you. There are tons of functionality points that, you know, I could highlight on that, but really that one is just show some people really like their coops pretty and some, you know, are more basic, which is perfectly fine. In that second photo there, I just wanted to highlight that again, that under area of the coop that they have there. In their design, they have that as well as an additional large run space. And you could easily modify that kind of plan or design to where that under coop area there could be a brooder box for your chicks, you know, juvenile chicken grow out pen where they still would have you know, introduction to the larger birds, but not necessarily to where they could, you know, be at risk of being injured or anything of that sort. You know, there's lots of opportunity there, but to me, that's a good example of being able to modify my current coop to be able to add chickens or separate a chicken if need be. In the third main photo there, I really just wanted to highlight there, I understand that those are ducks, obviously, but that there is an opportunity for chicken tractors or movable coops that you can rotate around certain areas and use electric netting to keep predators out or keep your birds in, recognizing that our chickens can fly. So typically most of them are not gonna jump over that fencing. They're gonna be, you know, satisfied with whatever's inside, but just a thought. And a thought about that, of course, is that flying predators are not gonna be deterred by an electric fence. So if that's a big consideration in your area, then that may not be the best opportunity for you. This fourth photo here, I just kind of, again, wanted to highlight how access is such an important part of design when you're talking about chicken coops. So this is a rather small, very simple A-frame chicken coop, you know, triangle shape there. It's got sort of a half door situation there. And all I can think about there is I can't easily step into that coop. I actually have to step up and over that second bar. And they have a very large feeder in there, which tells me it's probably very heavy and or very annoying to refill, empty, clean, anything of that sort. They have a 5 gallon bucket of water, you know, pulling all of that out. It's just going to be kind of aggravating getting in and out of that. So again, just a point of how access is really a key part of your design. It's really great for chickens, not that great for, you know, the human factors we have there in caring for our chickens. And then just that last photo there, just showing you can be really detailed in your planning methods for this. The more detailed you are, if you're, you know, real techie like me, you could build 3D designs, you could build digital plans like this, but even just a written out plan showing, you know, the sizing, the square footage, the footage of each line, where things are gonna go, you know, and kind of walk it through in your mind. Any kind of pre-planning you can do like that is going to really help the overall execution of your coop. So I am a habitual planner. I am probably going to plan way more than I need to. But again, in the end, I end up feeling a lot better because I can make those modifications before I get to the headache of, oh, I really should have done that and not this. So that's all I have. I'd be happy to answer some questions if you have some specifics on your coop. I've put my email address here and my county phone, but you are welcome to send me photos of your coop if you need suggestions. If you have a tentative design and you want some input on it, I'm happy to respond or do anything of that. And I don't think I saw any major questions, but...
No, we just had somebody having trouble seeing the slides, but that was their system. There haven't been any questions, just my comment on no lead paint. Mm-hmm. In your coops, make sure that you do not have, you know, access to anything that has lead paint in it. Make sure your yard does not have contamination from anything that could contain lead, because the lead can end up in the eggs or the meat if you are contaminated areas. So, especially if you have kids. What's that?
I said unbeknownst to you, unfortunately.
Yeah.
it does get in there. Yeah, and
So.
I see a lot of people recommending like cedar siding and cedar shingles and stuff, which cedar potentially can have some toxic properties for chickens as well. So I always recommend if you are going to do that, you know, it's great to have it on the outside, but better to have like a pine board or something on the inside just in case chickens are pecking at that, scratching, or if the board starts to deteriorate, they're not, you know, accessing that as well.
So, got a question. Planning on repurposing a 4 foot by 8 foot garden bed and removing the potting soil. What material should we fill the bed with? We have up to 4 chickens in Orlando, Florida. Just FYI.
So, Erica, is that like a raised bed you're talking about, or
Yes.
yes, okay. So, yeah, definitely want to remove the potting soil because that's going to contain, you know, a little slow relief fertilizer in there. It's likely going to have some perlite or vermiculite in there, which is, you know, basically like little styrofoam pieces. So we want to remove all of that, of course. I would just, you know, depending on how much you are going to fill it up with a 4 by 8 raised bed. It's about 32 square feet. So yeah, I mean you could make a section of that your enclosed coop and then make a section of that your run. If you were going to have to fill the whole thing, you could definitely look at some bagged fill dirt. It doesn't have to be very deep, or if there's no bottom to it, I mean, you could just place it on the natural ground and build up from there. We don't have too many problems with digging predators in suburban areas. Here in Florida, foxes are really the only main concern we have there.
No alligators.
No, they're not very good diggers. Well, I say that they do, you know, nest in the ground, but. I sure hope your alligators aren't coming for your chickens in your neighborhood.
It's true. They do have a lot of raccoons, she says.
Yeah, so raccoons, so we don't see digging a lot. They do reach into your chicken coop, especially if you use chicken wire. I've seen that a lot. They will reach into the coop and pull chicken heads out, or climb into the coop. So we want to make sure that we have you know, good roof structure on there. So whether tin or hardware cloth or something of that sort. But they're not a huge, I mean, unless they're just really starving and they are really on the hunt for your chickens, we don't have a major issue with digging with them.
They do like eggs though too, so watch over that.
Yeah,
Okay.
so always have lockable nest boxes or a way to contain them out of your nest boxes.
What recommendation do you have for feed and equipment storage?
I mean, I'm a big fan of those larger coops again, where you can have multi-utilization of space. So, like that shed example here, I'll scroll back to. You know, this big white shed here, you can see in there they have a bench and kind of a that the person that posted that on Facebook that I stole from had a lot of interior pictures as well. And so they have one sectioned off section where their chickens have access to, and then feed and storage in that they can lock it up. The biggest thing is, and I'm not sure where you are located in the country, Amy, but you know, any type of metal trash can is going to be helpful. You know, something that we can clean or lock if you have issues with bears, if you're in a mountainous region, or something that is going to be a big factor there is, you know, a locking trash can from bears. Even in Florida, we face a lot of bear issues getting into trash and feed. So, if you have a coop like one of these other examples here where you don't have space for feed or equipment or anything, I mean, really, my best recommendation would be to purchase some type of small shed. You know, even the plastic ones that people keep like pool toys and things in, a deck box can be helpful. Something that's going to keep it away from weather and animals are going to be the biggest factors there.
The metal can's important to keep out rodents. Otherwise, you're going to have mice, maybe rats in your feed, and they're going to eat most of it and contaminate, and salmonella can become issues and other things.
Yep, certainly. If you're using any type of plastic, make sure you're regularly inspecting that for holes that mice are getting into. And no mothballs outside. That's illegal and it doesn't work. So it won't deter rats, snakes, anything of that sort. I feel like I always have to recommend that for chicken programs as well.
Any other questions? While you're thinking to see if you've got any more, next month's webinar is actually on Election Day, November 5th. And it is on budgeting for small and backyard flocks. So things to think about, you know, the cash flow with a backyard flock or small flock. This is being recorded. It will be posted later tonight, probably. If you have any topics that, if you've been to our our website that's got all the lists of all the previous ones, when you don't see anything upcoming on something you want, then just email me with your suggested topic. And as I'm working on 2025 webinars, so just let me know if there's something you'd like to see discussed in a webinar. So thank you very much, Alicia. That's a great presentation, covered a lot of topics, a lot of things to give people thoughts about. The webinar does, the recording does not get sent out. It gets sent to, it gets posted on the website and where you registered. What do you call it? The page. Let me see where, what was the, it'll be posted on the eExtension site. It's also posted on our YouTube page. So if you go to our homepage, we have a YouTube channel. We have a Facebook channel, a Facebook page. It all gets posted there. Whoops, it's not what I was looking for. Where are you? Come on, go home, go home. Copy and all of our recordings are listed on that poultry.extension.org page. All the past recordings and the information for the upcoming websites, webinars. Not seeing any more questions, I think. Just lots of thank yous. I'm sure they appreciated it. So everybody stay safe. And for those in Florida, Georgia, North Carolina, I hope that you are recovering from the damage that you suffered, and you're in everybody's thoughts and prayers. Thank you very much, everybody. Hope to see you next month.
Thanks, Jackie.
Bye.